Hello everybody, and a very big welcome back to Tony Northeastern, and I hope you're all keeping safe and well, and you're looking forward to another madcap episode of Working on the Railway, in miniature form of course. Right, so this is where we left off last time, and as you can see, the ice cream is flashing perfectly this time. I don't know what it was, but it does seem to be working a lot better than what it did before when we came to the last, or the end of the last video. Anyway, let's mosey on over to Tyne Dock Station. Last time over at Tyne Dock, we had just put in the centre canopy. So now we're going to look at putting both roofs on, and then we're going to see how it lies so we can work out what I'm going to do with the canopy and how it meets against these walls. So let's take this building over to the bench. The first thing I want to do is add some more brick fascia onto the building, and it'll match what we have along the base of the building, and it'll do two things. It'll give us a height of where to put the guttering, and also it'll give us a little bit of an edge there for the gluing of the roof as well. So that's the first thing I want to do before I start on the roofs. I have now finished putting the purple bricks all the way around the station on the top edge, as you can see. So that's that done. So what I'm doing now is I'm adding more of these apexes to support the roof. So I've put that one in, and wherever I've got 80 millimeters or more, I will add more supports in. I'm just glad that when I drew the apex originally, that I kept the drawing like we have here. And here's one I've made earlier. So it's 70 mil wide, 64 in between the walls, and also obviously I've notched this a little bit out so it misses the terminal blocks. I'll go smack in the center there, and that will be glued in. So I've got a fair few more of these to make before I tackle the roof, so I shall carry on regardless. And finally, we are making a start on the roofs, and what we got here is the smallest roof out of the two for the station build. This one will cover the porter's room, the lift, and the refreshments room. You probably noticed that this is just a Metcalf roof tiling sheet, and all I'm doing is scoring the lines and highlighting the tiles to give it a more definition to its look, if you like. And for those of you who are new to the channel, this is how sometimes I do my roofs, and it does work. Let me show you a couple of examples. And here is a classic example of what I've done just by using the Metcalf roofing sheets. As you can see, the closer I go in, the deeper the detail of all these tiles that have been scribed. Oh, thumbs upside down. There we go. And it highlights each and every one of the tiles, as you can see there. So this is just one example of how the roofs can look just by scribing them with a pen. And here is a Metcalf kit with that very same look, where I've scribed the card and then painted over the top. The only thing is here, I have not added any capping stones to the roof. Even these mid-calf terraced houses has had the same treatment, if you like. But here I've added the capping stones. So yeah, if you're building a mid-calf kit and you want to enhance your roofs, just pen and scribe. Simples. Although it does take a bit of effort in doing this, but I think it is well worth it just to add that different dimension. Now, I've always used a black pen for doing this because sometimes the ink does come through the paint even after a couple of coats. So black pen is definitely preferred for doing this type of work to your roofs. The only thing I must emphasize, if you're doing this, you've got to press quite firmly onto the card to make sure you get the impression left by the pen. So that's normally just two or three times, pressing quite firmly on the tile marks left on the original print. And another thing you've got to be careful of is you don't miss any of the tiles. So now and again, just pick it up and look along the in the light, and you can see where you may have missed some tiles. And if you have, then you just go over them again. I use a rule to do the straight lengths of this roof, pressing really hard, just a few times. And before we start marking out the tiles. Now, although we can't see where I'm going to cut the roof on this side, if I flip the roof over, you can see where I've done all the measuring. So I've measured for the chimney breast, and I've measured for where I'm going to cut out the roof later on. And if you look really close here, you can see the imprint has come right through the card. So that's how firmly you've got to press to ensure you get the desired effect once you've painted. And now we have the first roof installed. And yeah. Looking good so far. It might look tall, but by the time you add the canopy support in there and then another roof sloping back up against that wall, then the building won't look as narrow as it is tall. It'll come out in width, so it shouldn't look odd, as it were. So yeah, and that's taken me about an hour and a half to do that, measuring and cutting, and also putting some extra stiffeners in between the apexes, just to stop any the card doing that. But yeah, so we have the first section in place. You may think measuring these ends is complicated. Well, it's not really. Once you've got your main roof in and you've got an open end like this. Now I've cut that back here on the edge of this last support. So now we will have a slope on the end roof. But to get that triangle, it is quite straightforward. You measure the two tips there and there, and it works out at 81.5 millimeters. Now, I've left an overhang all the way around this station by 4 millimeters. So if you put your rule 4 millimeters over the edge of the wall and measure up to where the apex starts, and it works out roughly about 43 millimeters. And then once you've got that tip and that tip measurement and the height, all you got to do is mark out the triangle and you've got the piece that will fit in there. And here is the markings out. Obviously I put the camera down and re-measured again, and it's 44 millimeters for the overhang, and there's the 81.5. so we've just got to mark out the center, which is 40.75 to the center of this line, and then mark that up. All you've got to do then is from that corner to that corner is cut out your triangle, and then hopefully that should fit. So here we are, moment of truth. Let's see if this piece of card fits. So there we go, we'll just push that tip into the corner there, right, so it's in, and we'll have a look at this edge because it's easier to see. And I think I'm a little bit over, which is not a lot, it's about probably a half a millimeter over on that corner here. So we can just take that off along that lower edge, and then we can scribe this card and then glue that in place. But I'll have to make up some return tabs to give this corner some strength, and maybe put in a support in here as well. So that should work. Before I stick the triangular piece in, I have added an extra support, which if you look closely is a T-piece which goes onto the back apex, if you like, back in there. And I've added two tabs, so hopefully the triangular now should just sit on there once it's glued. And now for the other roof. The other roof is quite long. It's longer than a sheet of Metcalf card. It works out at 310 millimeters. So what I've done is I've trimmed the end off one of the card and cut it down to 270. And to make up the extra 40 mil, I've just cut another piece of the same card but in the same plane. So hopefully once it's joined together you can't see the joint, hopefully. So the best way to go about this is to stick a fine piece of card underneath the original size of 270 on that line, and then butt the other one up to it, and then we can start scribing. But what we'll do, we'll use this end as the end wall, and then we'll do the mitering at this end, and that way it'll be stronger to do it here than it would be to do it here. At least we'll keep this joint hopefully where it's not going to be seen that much. So that's the plan of action for this roof, and then we'll just scribe as we've done with the other roof to finish. So that's the only slight difference, is we've had to join a piece of card to make the roof the right length. So here we go, up to the line, and then we'll just glue this piece to there, keeping the tiles in line, and then we should be able to scribe the card. I am well in to tiling this roof now. I've been at it now for about an hour, and I've done one side, so I'm just now imprinting the other side, I think I may have said this before, it does take a lot of time to individually scribe each and every one of these tiles, but you know, it is worth it if you're willing to put the effort in. And I'm pressing down quite hard with this pen. And you can see the difference between the scribed and the not scribed, and it is quite prominent. You can feel each and every one of these tiles. I have now marked out for the chimney breasts, and there's three of them on the main building. And let me explain how I have done this. All those bits of card I've been adding to this wall has now made the wall 6 millimeters thick. Now I want 4 millimeters of that for the capping stones, and that leaves me 2 millimeters on this wall for allowing the roof card to sit on there on that apex. And by taking a measurement from the chimney breast to the first piece of card, if you like, the first thickness of 2 mil gives me roughly about 59 millimeters, and this is how we have marked it out, using this card here as the datum point for each and every one of these chimneys as we go along. So we started off at 59, and then the thickness of the chimney breast, which is roughly about 11 millimeters, but I'm allowing 12 millimeters just because this piece of card around here just overlaps by a fraction on this chimney. And then measuring the gap between there, which is 69, and then so on and so on and so on, but always taking the measurement from this point. And hence why we now have the three cutouts for the chimney breast. So I shall cut them out and we shall see if my calculations have worked out correctly. Well, that seemed to have worked out quite well with the spacings of the cutouts. And yes, we've got a little bit of a gap here and here, but I'm not worried about that because we've got the lead flashing to go around the chimney breasts, which will come later. As for the end here, I have cut that out exactly the same way as I've cut out the original roof at the other end of the building, so hopefully it'll end up something like that when it's done. So that now is ready to be stuck down. I can quite confidently say I can put that down. We seem to have the same amount of overhang as the other roof, so it all seems to be matching perfectly. So I shall stick this roof down. I bet you thought all the scribing was finished, but it's not, because now I'm working on the ridge tiles that run across the tops of the roofs, and that involves a lot more scribing. Now I'm using quite thin card here, 0.5, probably less than that, but it's good quality card. Pick it up anywhere. WH Smith's has it, or the range. And what I'm doing, I'm marking some 5 mil lines, and then once I've done a page worth, I will then cut 8 mil strips, fold them in half, and then that will then become the ridge tiles for the roof. But I'm going to do something slightly different with this station. I'm going across the top of the ridge tiles. I'm going to add some 1 mil half round to create a ridge on the ridge tiles, if you know what I mean. So that'll be different. I've not done that before, and it'll be interesting to see how that looks once it's painted. But for now, I shall carry on scribing. Now we shall cut these lines into 8 mil strips. So I'm just measuring 4 millimeters from the edge, and 4 millimeters is this end. And what I'm going to do here is add a fold line. So very lightly with a pencil, and then move it out to 8 millimeters, which should be enough to cover the ridge of the roof. So 8 millimeters there, and 8 millimeters there. And let's check here. Then we should cut the strip. Then we'll just fold this strip at the fold line. Just a case of pinching the edge together and making sure the corner meets first. And once you've got the corner meet, then you can just use your finger and thumb and then just keep pinching all the way along that line right till the end. Don't take long to do this bit. And once you get to the end, then you can just pull it through your fingers nice and tight, just making sure you've got your fold line in line, and that's ready to be trimmed to size and then fit onto your roof. And once you've trimmed it to size, it's just a case of gluing in place, making sure that we're equal on either side of the roof. And that's it, that's your ridge tiles done. But we're not quite finished there, so just take off any excess glue that we may have. And once that's dry, there's a case of adding some 1 mil round or something like that just to run along the top. But we'll have to, as you can see, I've stuck some 1 mil round rod to the top of the ridge tiles, using some contact adhesive. What you might have to do, you might have to run the contact adhesive along an edge of the round rod before putting it on, and then once it's on there and you've got it centralized to the center of your tiles, then you can run the contact adhesive down either side, and that should stick it to the card. Now, it does work. I have stuck plastic strip to card before on the South Shields roof, and that does tend to work. Now, I'm only going to do this to the top ridge tiles. I ain't going to do it down the side tiles, if you like, or the side slopes of the roof. Just along the tops, just to give that roof a little bit of an interesting feature. Like I say, so I've not done this before, so I'm not sure how it's going to turn out once it's painted. Once the glue has gone off, what I will do is I'll use a scalpel, and then where your 5 mil lines are, I'll just put a mark across each one as we go along before I paint it, just to see if we can add a line or a join line or a ridge line on that rod before we paint it. As you can see, I've added the ridge tiles here, and I've put a small mil hole right on this Y, if you like. So I'm just going to open it up to 2.5. There's a good reason why I'm doing this, which I'll show you. Just take some of that away, because I found some of these in my common handy box, these finials. So I'm going to put one of these on each end of the building before I put in the rod. I know it's probably not a good idea to add this kind of detail in just yet, but if it's in there, I can get the distance right for the rod that's going to be glued in there. Hence why I'm doing this now. So I'll just super glue that in place, make sure it's in the center, and cut the rod to go in between. Now we're going to add the lead flashing that goes around the chimney breast here, and all I'm doing for that is a strip of 3mm paper that's been folded in half. And here we have some little pieces already cut and ready to be stuck in situ. Now, I don't know if we can show you this, but if you look closely, it's been shaped and cut to go over the top of the ridge tiles and mitered to go into that corner. So we'll just put a little bit of glue in that corner, and then we can fit this one. And I can zoom you in to show you what I mean. So I'll just put a little bit of glue in that corner, make it run down to the first tile below the chimney breast, because that's where the lid flashing is going to go. So then we pick up our little tiny piece of paper and just put that into the corner, and then I'll show you what it looks like before it actually sticks in place. And this is what I mean about trimming the paper in half. 4mm, which rests up against the chimney breast, and then just come down, and then that last little bit will just fold it round the chimney breast, just like the real lead flush. And the next piece that goes on the other side will be exactly the same, and then the bit that ties it all in is this piece along there. And once it's done, this is what it should look like before it gets painted. And finally, we have a building that looks more like a station now that it's got its roof on. And just in time for the winter weather. Which is a bit funny really, because yesterday when I was up here, I was absolutely chucking it down with rain. And if you look outside now, it's like a summer's day. Anyway, typical old British weather. So, the roof is on, and a final touch I have added before I brought the building back over to its platform is I've added some capping stones across this edge. This is not finished yet, because you can see the end capping stone seems to be hanging in the air, so we need a nice little decorative stone to go underneath those, just to give that a little bit of support, something like what we've got here. Underneath there, some sort of cornice heading stone, but yeah, I'm quite happy with the way that the roof has turned out. Although it's not painted yet, that will be probably towards the end of the build, once all the other canopies are up and secured. But yes, it does look tall and narrow. I think I may have mentioned this already, but once we get the other canopy on, which comes out further from this wall, it will add a bit more width and probably depth to the building. But yeah, and that little finishing touch on the end there. Now if I pan across to the signal box, they have a similar type of finials on their roof there, so more or less copying what I've seen elsewhere, but it might not be a part of the original Tyne Dock Station, but it's another little detail. Right, so other thing I've done is I've finally got round to capping off this wall. I've just managed to do that, so that will be requiring some paint to bring it to this kind of shady, dirty black. So progress is progress. Every little tiny bit I do just seems to help progress this area. So, on that note, I think that's all from me. Hope you've enjoyed what you've seen, and we'll see you again soon. Thanks for watching now. Bye.